Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure is depressing. More to the point, it's about the depression of the 1930s, a time remembered by many South Dakotans as the hardest, leanest years of their lives. We're here on the restored Main Street at Prairie Village in Madison to uncover the circumstances that led to the Great Depression. Now, you know what a depression is. Let's say you've made plans for a special picnic, and then it rains. Well, that bad feeling you have, that's a depression. Well, during the dirty 30s, many South Dakotans' businesses were depressed, and so were most of the people. What was it about the 30s that made them the most difficult 10 years in South Dakota history? Well, that's today's South Dakota adventure. For one thing, the 30s were the years of the Great Depression, a time when many people were unemployed and farmers were paid very little for their crops. There was also a serious drought, and sometimes there were terrible storms of blowing dust. Farmers couldn't raise crops during those years, and tourism, which had just started as an industry, was stopped dead in its tracks by the high cost of traveling. People were simply too poor to take vacations. The dirty 30s were a rough time for South Dakota. So what caused this Great Depression? Most folks say it began October 29th, 1929, on Black Tuesday, the day the stock market crashed. People had been buying stocks and were paying more for them in the years before 1929. Then some people began to think the price was going to go down, so they started to sell. And this caused a panic, and with everyone trying to sell and nobody willing to buy, the bottom fell out of the market. The stock market crash was really only one of the causes of the Great Depression. Many businessmen and factory owners had feared something like a crash when they realized that most factories were making more goods than they could sell. So they began to slow down production and lay off their workers. As workers couldn't find jobs, they began to worry that maybe the bank wouldn't be able to give them all of their savings. So they withdrew their money. When everyone started to do that, some banks couldn't pay all their customers and had to close. Some people never got their money back. With fewer people working, grocery stores, restaurants, clothing stores, and other businesses had fewer customers. And then many of these businesses had to cut back and lay off workers. People traveled less, and the rail and truck lines started losing money. And as prices fell, so did the prices of farm goods. At one point during the Depression, farmers would receive only 35 cents for a bushel of wheat, $20 for a cow. President Herbert Hoover, congressmen and business leaders urged people not to panic. Businesses were asked to find jobs for the unemployed. Town and county governments were asked to put out-of-work people on their payrolls. Churches and clubs tried to help people find jobs. The Federal Farm Board tried to buy part of the farmers' crops and store them to keep the price of wheat from going down. Unfortunately, none of these actions made much of a difference. And by 1932, one out of every four workers had lost his job. Many farmers were broke and were losing their farms because they couldn't pay their debts. Men who had been bank presidents and engineers were selling apples to make a living. Bread lines and soup kitchens were set up to feed the unemployed. People who had lost their homes because they couldn't pay their debts were living in shacks made of old boxes or anything they could find. Because many people blamed the president for the poor conditions, they called these shack towns Hooverville. The Great Depression was a hard time for all parts of the United States, but it was especially hard on South Dakota. Remember, our farmers didn't have much money during the 20s before the Depression, and farming was the number one industry in South Dakota. With prices so low, farmers couldn't pay their bills, so businesses that traded with farmers were hurt too. Farmers quit buying things they couldn't afford. They discovered they were better off burning their corn for heat during the winter than selling it at low prices. So people selling coal didn't do much business. And people without money, well, they went cold and hungry. Many farmers and businessmen who couldn't pay their debts lost their farms and businesses. How could people live through such hard times? Well, South Dakotans did what they had to survive. People who lost their homes moved in with relatives, or they moved back east. People lived off what they could farm or hunt. Some of the unemployed returned to the Black Hills to pan for gold. Some left for the orchards of Washington and Oregon. Men rode freight trains looking for work, and they would take any job they could get, regardless of the pay. The hard times in our state made some people unhappy and angry. Farmers couldn't understand why the prices they received for their crops were so low. One attempt to raise farm prices was called the Farm Holiday Association. Farmers had hoped to get everyone to agree not to sell any crops or livestock. They believed that when the buyers ran out of farm products, the price would increase. When some farmers refused to withhold their crops, farmers armed with shotguns tried to close the roads to Sioux Falls and Sioux City. These people weren't violent, but they were confused, frustrated, and angry about the hard times. Many South Dakotans chose to tell politicians how unhappy they were when they voted in 1932. The Republicans, who had controlled the White House in Washington and the state capitol in Pierre, were voted out of every office. For the first time in history, the Republicans didn't elect a single constitutional officer in South Dakota. Everyone from the governor to the state auditor was a Democrat. And the Democrats also controlled the legislature. The only Republican to keep his seat was Senator Peter Norbeck. So in Pierre, we had a new governor, Belvedere rancher Tom Berry. And in Washington, we had a new president, Franklin D. Roosevelt. Both in Washington and Pierre, the government tried to develop new ways of meeting the problems of the Great Depression. President Roosevelt had promised a new deal for the American people if he was elected. As his presidency began in the spring of 1933, South Dakotans waited to see what the New Deal meant for them. And one of the New Deal key hopes was to help farmers. A number of new programs were begun to make things better for agriculture. The Agricultural Adjustment Act, everyone called it the AAA, paid farmers to cut down on the number of acres they planted and the head of livestock they raised. Again, the idea was if there was less product, demand and price would increase. To cut down on the numbers right away, crops were plowed under. And in 1933, thousands of baby pigs were killed in South Dakota. This practice made some people angry, since there were people going hungry. But farm prices did go up some by 1934, and that was a big help to a lot of farmers. Other New Deal programs that helped South Dakota farmers include the Farm Credit Act, which helped with farm loans, and the Commodity Credit Corporation, which helped raise farm prices. Governor Berry and the South Dakota legislature passed laws that made it easier for South Dakotans to pay their taxes and provided help for farmers to manage their loans. All sorts of other things were done to help the state through the Depression. To save money, the state sold its unprofitable coal mining and hail insurance businesses. The state cut its funding for almost all programs. And in some instances, like supportive colleges, funding was cut in half. That way, employees could at least keep their jobs, but at half pay. Work on new roads and repairs on city and state buildings were put off until better times. New Deal programs also had quite an effect on South Dakotans who weren't farmers. The Federal Emergency Relief Administration provided money for state and county governments. The Civilian Conservation Corps organized men to build roads in the Black Hills National Forest and dams for water on the thirsty prairie. The Works Progress Administration, called the WPA, had people doing everything from raking leaves to building buildings. So by the mid-30s, South Dakota, with the help of the New Deal, had made a start on helping people through the Depression. Farm prices were getting better, and there were now ways to help farmers save their farms. And people in towns had some way to get relief payments. The WPA and the CCC provided some jobs for the unemployed. South Dakota had a long way to go, but things seemed to be getting better. Some of the early years of the 30s had been dry. There had also been some problems with grasshoppers. But if those years were bad, they were nothing compared to 1934 and 35. Some parts of the state hadn't seen any rain in 2 years. Clouds of dust hid the sun as prairie winds blew. The dust covered roads and fences like snowdrifts. and grasshoppers ate what didn't blow away. South Dakota and neighboring states received a new name, the Dust Bowl. To many South Dakotans, the dust storms were the worst part of the Depression. People could find jobs. Oh, and they could find help paying their taxes. But they couldn't stop the dust. Former Vice President Hubert Humphrey recalled that it was the dust that made him leave the South Dakota he loved. Many other South Dakotans left with him. But somehow, those who stayed behind made it through those Dust Bowl years. Farmers learned to strike back by changing their farming methods, leaving strips of unplowed fields to hold the soil in place. Shelter belts to stop the wind were planted with government help, and some cropland was turned back to pasture. Dams were built so livestock would have water through future droughts. Farmers and ranchers who made it through the dirty 30s said, "We never want this to happen again." In spite of all the trouble South Dakotans had in the 1930s, some good things happened too. Remember that Coolidge had dedicated Mount Rushmore in 1927. Starting with Washington's face, sculptor Gutzon Borglum and his crew swung from ropes to carve the four granite faces on Mount Rushmore. And by the end of the 30s, the mountain looked much like it does today. And South Dakota had a stone sculpture unlike anything else in the world. There were also some less tangible benefits from the Great Depression. South Dakotans were drawn closer to each other as they faced common challenges. Everyone pitched in with what they had to make it better for everyone else. Families had little money to spend, so they made their own entertainment. Many families had radios. Some of the favorite programs were nationally broadcast, like George Burns and Gracie Allen, or The Arthur Godfrey Show. Locally, people could listen to George B. German, Ben Norman, or Lawrence Welk on WNAX in Yankton. Most South Dakota towns had a movie theater, but that was expensive. A dime for the show and a nickel for popcorn. Television had made its first appearance in the World's Fair in 1933, but it wasn't until 20 years later that the first television set was turned on in South Dakota. So for the most part, people made their own entertainment, much the same as the early pioneers had done 50 years earlier. So there were some good times during the Dirty 30s. South Dakotans who lived through that time can take pride in the fact that they were strong enough to live through perhaps the toughest time in our state's history. Most of us would rather not have to do it again. Despite not having much, it would not be long before South Dakotans would be asked to defend what they did have with their lives. How we answered that call is our next South Dakota adventure.